thing we're going to be talking this morning about Down syndrome. Just as a way of more introduction, I'm a little overdressed for Saturday morning today, but I'm heading to a fundraiser this morning for our center at Bloomingdale's of all places, so it's the outfit. So as part of that, they asked for my bio, just sort of somewhat like what you heard just now, because they'll be introducing me, and the person in charge wrote back and said, well, Dr. Bell, thank you for the bio, but it doesn't tell me one thing. It doesn't tell me why you do what you do. So could you tell me that in one sentence? That's actually not a very easy thing to do. Because it's not easy to put into words, but I suspect that's pretty much the same reason why you're all sitting here this morning on a Saturday morning, early in the morning, dedicating your time and efforts to a population of children that needs your services, perhaps a lot more than other kids. So I'm still not sure how I'm going to put that into that one sentence, but I'll try to sort it out. But who can look at this cute little face and not want to be there for that person? So the listed topic in the syllabus is the physical and motor characteristics of Down syndrome, and this year I added behavioral characteristics because I think that tells us a lot about how to interact with children with Down syndrome who do have some unique qualities different from other children with other types of conditions that might have a similar mental capability. So just as means of quick background, you know, what is Down syndrome? One important piece of information is that previously Down syndrome was apostrophe S, Down's syndrome. And over the years in genetics, we've decided to get away from the apostrophe S because Dr. Down doesn't own Down syndrome. So the more proper way to do it is without adding the apostrophe S there. So Dr. Down was a British physician who first described Down syndrome in the 1800s. He actually thought it had something to do with mothers who had tuberculosis during pregnancy, because of course the two were fairly rampant back then, in terms of the tuberculosis. It wasn't until the 1950s that the chromosomal basis for Down syndrome was discovered. What we mean by syndrome is just a set of physical or developmental features that occur together in a fairly predictable fashion, though there is variation, and are thought to be or known to be due to a specific single cause. And there's some old-fashioned terminology that is sometimes still used, although unfortunately not used very much anymore, and one is mongoloidism. Back in Dr. Down's day, his description of children reminded him of people who were from Mongolia in terms of their physical characteristics, and that's where that term came from. And then from a medical standpoint, we also use the term trisomy 21 to indicate the chromosomes, and we'll look at those now, the cause of Down syndrome. So here's the chromosomes. All except the 21st chromosomes, this package of chromosomes in this picture could be any one of us in here. In terms of these chromosomes and their size and shape, they're all pretty much the same. These nice, unimpressive looking stripy sticks is what I like to call them. We typically have 46 of them. They come from pairs. One of these comes from the father, one from the mother, and we number them and line them up from the tallest ones down to the smallest ones. Leading over here, the chromosomes that determine male and female. So this would be male because there's one X chromosome, one Y chromosome, as opposed to two X chromosomes. Here's where the difference lies. Right here, there's three 21st chromosomes rather than two, making for a total of 47 chromosomes rather than 46. And technically speaking, the 21st chromosome is actually smaller than the 22nd chromosome, but when they were first numbered, the 22nd chromosome, microscopes weren't good, so they couldn't see the full top and bottom of the 22. They just never reordered them afterwards. So this is the whole cause of Down syndrome here, just having this one extra chromosome. In theory, if we could turn off that chromosome somehow, especially early during the pregnancy, we might be able to eliminate or ameliorate some of the features. And it's an active area of research trying to sort out what genes are on there and how we can maybe modulate those genes to help prevent some of the difficulties for these folks. Newer technology just allows us, instead of having to do this, which takes time to culture the cells, look under the microscope. This pretty much has to be done by a real person. It can't exactly be computerized. It's very time intensive and takes a couple of weeks before we get this test result. Nobody wants to wait several weeks before they can determine whether a child has Down syndrome or not, especially during infancy. New technology just allows us to add this little set of colored probes. The red ones attached to the 21st chromosomes, the green ones are control to make sure that we know it's working. And here we have three red lights where we should only have two, so this test can come back fairly rapidly within a matter of a day and a half, probably. There are some other types of Down syndrome. One of them is mosaicism, and the other is above yourself, this whole thing here. But if you look at this cluster of cells down here, you see some are white, some are black. The black dotted ones have 46 chromosomes in them, the others have 47. And it's essentially just that there's two sets of cells in that person. This explains how it happens. Usually there's 47 chromosomes at the time of conception, and then at some point, some of the cells lose that extra chromosome. In theory, people with mosaicism, you would expect, might be less affected because they have some cells that have the typical chromosome number in them. And to some extent, that's true. I don't tend to dwell on it with families because I've seen children that have mosaicism have as similar a course as children with full-blown trisomy 21. And I think sometimes it's hard for families when we don't, you know, we say your child doesn't have mosaicism and they get disappointed and think they won't do as well. It's really not a big determinant of how well the kids do. And there's one other type that's fairly rare where there's 46 chromosomes because the chromosomes are counted by, based on these structures. On this particular chromosome here, there's another chromosome that's just flipped upside down and stuck to the top of it physically. It's technically still 321st chromosomes. It's known as translocation Down syndrome. It doesn't act any different than other types of Down syndrome, other than there's a confusion when you're looking that there's 46 chromosomes and you're expecting 47. In some cases, a parent can carry this chromosome here so that they actually have 45 chromosomes instead of 46 because they have two stuck together. When that happens, they have a higher chance of having a child with Down syndrome, and then if they had one child with Down syndrome, a higher chance to have another. Whereas typically, with just an extra 21st chromosome, we tell parents the chance for it to happen in another child that they may have is fairly low. Lots of genes on this chromosome, and again, we're not going to go anywhere near these genes, but just to sort of show you that they've started to identify all these different genes, and they're trying to sort out what they do. And I just happened to across this last night. This is one gene that's important for brain and nerve development. The typical pathway for the gene to work is up here. In this one here, this extra gene material that's found in Down syndrome is blocking this process so that this particular enzyme is inactive. This compound can't make it into the nucleus, and it's blocking some of the normal development. Why do kids differ from Down syndrome? If you've started working with kids with disabilities, particularly kids with Down syndrome, you'll know that they're alike in many ways, but still unique, obviously, as we all are. But even there's still a fair range of difference for kids with Down syndrome. Obviously, they're going to differ older versus younger. Their family backgrounds are important. Now, this is one chromosome out of 47. We have 30,000 genes in the body. The Down syndrome chromosome carries about 200-300 of them. So their other genetic makeup is important. There's a lot of associated medical problems and issues in Down syndrome. For a child that has a congenital heart disease, that's going to impair their ability to exercise. It's going to have some impact on their muscle development, their neurologic development. Certainly if you have seizures as part of your syndrome, it's going to have some impact on how you're doing. So there's a lot of other reasons why we can have this variation. And of course, opportunity. So the children that you are fortunate enough to work with have families that can bring them here and get them here and work intensely with them, and other families don't have that access. There isn't a program like this for all families. Or they simply are not in a position where they can find this type of service for their children, particularly outside of the United States. So let's look a little more carefully at Down syndrome in terms of features. So we'll look today at some of the physical features, some of their motor characteristics, some of their behavior characteristics, and some of their medical issues. So here's beautiful little infants with Down syndrome. It shows some of the features that we look for when we get called into the nursery. These here are the eye openings that we call in medicine palpebral fissures, and they tend to go upwards from the inner corner to the outer corner. In this particular child, that's fairly subtle, actually. This child also doesn't have significant folds over the corners of the eyes, which sometimes we see in Down syndrome, which are called epicanthal folds. The whole middle part of the face tends to be a little bit smaller, makes them more prone to ear infections, sinus infections. When they get mucusy with a cold, they're more affected by it than another child of similar age because everything's a little smaller and it gets more difficult for them to breathe. There used to be this idea that children with Down syndrome had large tongues, and they always were noticed to have their tongues hanging out. And over time, it's become apparent that it's actually the mouth that's a little small. The tongue is a normal-sized tongue in a somewhat smaller mouth. And then because of their lower muscle tone, the tongue has more of a tendency to hang out of the mouth. Over time, that certainly improves, and to some extent, it's habit formed, so that parents will tell their kids, tongue in, to remind them to keep their tongue back in their mouth. Again, their nose can be a little bit shorter and sometimes turns up at the end. And ears tend to be a little bit smaller and placed a little bit lower on the head. Again, it's something that I prefer when I see babies, but isn't terribly relevant. And the neck is sometimes shorter and can have some webbing of the skin. I don't typically like these types of features because I don't pictures because they're not as endearing as actual children. But it was the only one that I could find that showed easily showed the other things that we see in the hand. One crease that goes across the palm. So if you all look at your hand, you'll see most of us have a crease up here and a crease just below that, as well as the one over here by the thumb. And Down syndrome is more likely to have just a single one that goes across the hand. For all of you out there who are panicking as you look and you go, oh my God, I've got that. 4% of the general population will have that on one side, and 1% of the general population will have it on both sides. So it's not a specific characteristic to Down syndrome. Again, it's an irrelevant feature. It doesn't make any difference to the child's function of their hand or anything to have a single crease. It's just an indicator of how that hand is folded before they were born and how these creases form. The fifth finger, the pinky finger, is often curved sideways, which has a fancy name called clinodactyly. And again, if you look at your fingers, you should have two major creases across your finger, and they should be parallel to one another. And in Down syndrome, there's often just a single crease, or if there are two creases, they angle towards each other because of the curvature. It tends to indicate that the bone in the middle of the finger is a little bit short, and again, really has very little to do with function or whatnot or interfering with anything. I sometimes tell families, I think that if you play the harp, you need your pinkies, so maybe your child would have difficulty playing the harp. But beyond that, it's really not terribly important. When we look at their feet, there's often a larger space between the first toe and the second toe that people call the sandal gap, because it's like where the, you know, the long sandal where the feet would go between the toes. I've actually worked with a geneticist when they called him to the nursery to find out if the baby had Down syndrome. He would pretend that he wasn't even going to look at the baby. He'd say, just show me their footprint sheet. And he'd look at it and go, yep, that baby's got Down syndrome. He'd turn to walk away. Because it's fairly characteristic, but again, certainly not diagnostic of Down syndrome. So here is those things that we were just talking about. So one of the things that's most concerning for infants is their muscle tone, which tends to be quite low, and so they're described as floppy babies. Typically, a baby of this age that's going through this process when the doctor's pulling on them like this will start with their head back like this, but will start to bring their head up, and then they sort of get tired and flops back down again. But babies with low tone, they really can't get that head back up at all. It's when you try to decide, and I don't know if you have background about muscle tone versus muscle weakness, sometimes families find it hard to understand that there's a difference between the two. And the easiest way I've found to explain is it's very much like a rubber elastic. So our muscles typically are like a rubber elastic that's got a little bit of stretch to it. It's already stretched at rest. And then when we go to make a muscle movement, we stretch that elastic much more and then bring it back to rest again. And with lower muscle tone, that elastic is very loose at rest. It doesn't have any tension to it at all. So for every movement that child needs to make, they have to get to kind of baseline tenseness before they can make the muscle movement, and just extra work for pretty much every muscle movement. Strength is different. Strength is the number of muscle fibers and the force that they can create. And you can increase strength with the activities that you're working on with the kids, and that helps compensate for the lower muscle tone. But there's not a whole lot we can do to correct muscle tone in terms of making the tone itself better. It tends to normalize as kids get older with Down syndrome, but relatively speaking, stays a little bit lower muscle tone throughout life. Our muscle tone also is one of the ways we're using calories when we're them to maintain weight properly and things like that. Because of the long tone and a variety of other things, like their smaller mouth and sometimes their medical issues like cardiac disease, feeding issues are very common. Kids tend not to grow very well early on. In fact, there's a special growth curve to use that's designed for children with Down syndrome. They have a higher chance of having reflux where they're spitting up a lot, losing their calories that way. So we watch their growth pretty carefully during infancy. Other medical issues are fairly common. So approximately half of kids with Down syndrome will have some type of congenital heart problem. Maybe severe enough to need surgery, but often just needs monitoring and will resolve on its own over time. They're a little more prone to trouble with their lungs and their breathing. Their stomach can have actual not being formed properly and maybe surgical repair. Again, with spitting up. Constipation is an extremely common problem pretty much throughout life for people with Down syndrome. And it may not sound like much, but if any of you have ever been in a situation where you've gotten yourself really pretty bound up, it's uncomfortable. And imagine that as your sort of general way of having to go through life. So kids can get distended bellies and kind of pain. They lose their appetite. It sometimes interferes with toilet training because they become fearful. It's hard to get hard stool out. It hurts. And kids become fearful of it. So it's actually something I talk about with every family when they come in for a visit to find out how that's going and can we help with that in terms of using some medications to keep things more regular. And still with feeding issues, the tongue not only tends to hang out of the mouth for muscle tone problems sometimes, but when you're a typical newborn, when you're born, if you're going to breast or bottle feed, you have to get your tongue down and out of your mouth for the bottle or the nipple to get in there. And that's a normal reflex that babies have. And Down syndrome, that reflex takes longer to go away. So when they transition to solid foods and you're putting the food in their mouth with a spoon, the tongue is coming back out with the food on it because the reflex is still there. And it's really like a reflex, like having your doctor tap your knee with a hammer. You have no control over what your knee does. It's a reflex action for the babies. And it just takes maturity for it to go away. But it's frustrating to the families. You know, they're trying to feed and everything's coming right back out. And then, unfortunately, there's not high chance procedures, but there is certainly chance procedures at any age in Down syndrome, particularly in infancy. And it may not bode well for their eventual development if there's seizures, especially if there are significant seizures. Hearing, another big problem for kids with Down syndrome, especially during their younger years. Everything is smaller. It doesn't drain as well. They tend to have chronic fluid in their ears, which means everything they hear is muffled. We tend to be very cautious with hearing. We have to have their hearing checked at least twice a year. Even though families say, no, like, you're fine. So I don't want to know that they hear loud noises and they hear when you drop something. I want to know that they're hearing whispers, which means we have to formally test to see for this. And they'll put ear drains in to help with the fluid or decongestants or other things because hearing is absolutely critical to developing your language. So the one thing we don't want to add is a problem with language development that we could have prevented by fixing a hearing issue. Language issues are already there for other reasons as well. And same with the vision. So vision issues are certainly higher in Down syndrome, and because you obviously need better to start seeing things and focus and whatnot for your development, we try to correct all of these correctable things during their childhood. The thyroid gland here in the neck is frequently a problem for people with Down syndrome. At the time they're born, up to 1 or 2% of them may have a low thyroid. Over a lifetime, it's up to 30 or 40% of people will have thyroid problems, usually low thyroid. Doesn't maybe sound like it's much of anything, but thyroid hormone during, before you're born and during infancy is actually critical to brain development. So it's another thing that these kids just can't afford to have missed. We miss it, their development doesn't do nearly as well, and that's a permanent issue. We correct the thyroid after the damage has been done. It's not very helpful. So all babies in the United States are screened at the time of birth for thyroid damage for this reason. And babies with Down syndrome, besides when they do that screen, are screened regularly twice in the first year of life and once every year after that for life. We test their thyroid. So turning to their motor development. So these are typical developing children when they perform these various things. So rolling around about 4 months, sitting around six, crawling about 6.5 months, walking somewhere around a year of age. If you compare that with children with Down syndrome, everything is going to be a little bit on the later side, although the early milestones are closer than the later ones. So rolling anywhere between 5 and 6.5 months, excuse me, sitting on average between 8 and 11 months, crawling between a year and a year and a half, and walking closer to 2 years, maybe 2.5 years. And if you look at the range, 74 months, I had to do the math, and that's fine, is 6 years and 2 months. So, you know, not walking until you're almost in first grade for a subset of these children. Usually related to the fact that their muscle tone is low. So I try to explain to families, you know, unfortunately, all of the things that we look at to track infant development are mostly motor. And speech and speech relies on your motor system as well. So I tell parents, don't get too discouraged if your child not walking till 3. That doesn't mean that your child is that much further behind and will always be that much further behind, because it's not really fair. We're not looking at their cognitive abilities, we're looking at their muscle tone abilities. Not that they're not related, but it's not a good measure. So I reassure them that how they're doing on their motor milestones really doesn't correlate how they're going to do later in terms of their cognitive abilities and their school abilities. So moving on. Developmentally, it actually is important for the brain and the muscles to get from the crawling position to the standing and walking position. And if we can help that out with the braces, they will eventually, those muscles will tighten up around the joint, ligaments will become a little bit tighter for most kids. Unfortunately, speech issues are a big issue. These are very social children, as you know. They love to be with people. They love to tell you all about themselves. And unfortunately, because of in fact, no one's entirely sure why they have some difficulty with their speech in terms of their articulation. Some of this muscle and the coordination, but that doesn't seem to be the whole picture. And no one's quite been able to pinpoint where that articulation difficulty comes from. And of course, you have a child, most children can understand language long before they can use language. And it's same as for children with Down syndrome, but that gap goes on longer than their typical developing children. And it's so frustrating. People would be like, if you dropped me in the middle of China, well, the opposite, I wouldn't understand anything that they told, but nobody would be able to understand me. It would be a very frustrating kind of situation. Sign language has been very beneficial for children with Down syndrome. It's easier for them to master in many ways. It helps bridge that gap between this is what I want to communicate to you, and I can go through the words, so I'm going to use sign. Traditionally, parents are a little fearful of using sign language because they were afraid that their child would become reliant on sign language and wouldn't learn. And study after study after study has shown that that's absolutely not true. People are driven to talk when it's possible. They will use words and they will drop signs as soon as they've got their word at a point where people understand it. And we actually have kids who refuse to use sign even though they still have trouble being understood. They just stop their foot and say, you better understand what I'm saying. So often on our part, it takes us, you have to really take a breath, get down to their level, physically to look them in the eye and really concentrate on what you're hearing and try to piece together what you think that child is saying. And if you really concentrate, you can usually start to pick up how they're saying words and become familiar with it. I often turn to the family for help when I really didn't catch a word and they'll interpret it for me. With some older kids, I will sometimes say, I really didn't understand that. Can you find some other way to tell me? And they sometimes will. Some of the kids are very motivated to really communicate and they'll do whatever to get you to understand them. We talked a little bit about why toileting might and it's a maturity issue as well. So where your average child might be toward the trainer, 3 or 4 years of age, children with Down syndrome are going to take a little longer and may not be toward the trainer by the time they start kindergarten or even first grade. The other thing that is different again about is somewhat specific to children with Down syndrome is that when they acquire a new skill, it isn't as, it doesn't stick as well. It's not as permanent. They may need to sort of keep relearning it before it really kind of sticks. And that's to some extent a little specific to children with Down syndrome compared to children with other causes of developmental issues. However, fortunately, their motor skills do improve over time, again, faster at the earlier ages, and then starts to taper off as they get a little bit older. Moving on to our toddlers, medical issues. From your standpoint, probably the thing that you most need to be aware of is the issue around the neck. To some extent, it's an overblown issue that freaks everybody out that these children have loose necks and they're going to get a spinal cord injury and they're going to become quadriplegic. If you look at x-rays of kids with Down syndrome, between 15 and 17% will have too much motion. They'll take the x-ray straight, all the way flexed this way, all the way extended this way, and they'll measure the difference how much that neck moves. And it should move less than 5 millimeters, which isn't very much, but it's too much if it's more than 5 millimeters. And you'll see that in a fairly good percentage of kids with Down syndrome. However, the actual severity of that outcome is really not there to go along with that problem. So people are always concerned about neck injuries. And when they look at the data, they say they've had so few kids that actually have any kind of neck injury. In fact, it's probably less than 1 to 2% of kids actually get neck injury. And in fact, almost none of those were direct related to trauma. They were more ongoing. The kids not walking as well as they were. Their quality is off compared to what it used to be. So there were often warning signs before the spinal cord damage that they'd been assessed for. So our job in pediatrics and in genetics is to really carefully make sure we watch reflexes and ask families about any changes that they might notice so that we can intervene if there is a symptomatic neck problem. But most of these kids don't have a real problem. The things that we recommend when that x-ray is abnormal and they don't have any symptoms, we don't want them putting stress on their neck, so we try not to do somersaults or tumbling, trampoline, diving, butterfly swim stroke, a lot of strain on the neck, and what we call collision sports like soccer, football, hockey, those kinds of things. To some extent, I think we're unfairly restricting kids who aren't going to get into trouble, but it's the safest route to take. Special Olympics requires it, which is the main reason that the x-rays are still done. There was a push about 10 years ago to stop doing x-rays because they seemed so silly, and we're restricting kids from activities. But because Special Olympics requires it, we still do them. We typically do them when their kids are 3, because the kids are old enough to cooperate, usually at that age, to do the motions they have to do, and the bone structure is dense enough that we can see it well in x-ray. So you may hear from some of the families if there's a problem with their child's neck or some concern about that. You guys may also be in a position to be on the first wave of people who notice something's new or something's different. The most obvious sign is something different from the way they're walking. So that's something you pick up on. You really want to alert the family to say, gee, this doesn't seem like the way you used to be doing things. Have you guys noticed that there's something different going on? And make sure that they're getting checked out. Constipation, there we've got 75% of toddlers are still having difficulty with constipation. And dry skin, almost all of them. It's again, it seems kind of silly, a dry skin, big deal. But these kids are often just plagued by very dry skin, cracked and whatnot, especially as we're heading into the winter months. So I often have conversations with families about how they're dealing with that. Hearing loss, again, still a pretty common issue. And we worry about sleep apnea. So you take a child who has a small airway, because the whole middle of their face is smaller, so their nose passages down into their throat, their larynx is smaller. You add to that little muscle tone, so the walls around it with those soft tissues is a little floppier. Then you throw in a cold or big tonsils that kids get at this age, and it's a recipe for disaster. Sleep apnea means you can't, you're breathing against obstruction, basically. You're trying to get air in and it can't move very easily. And so I ask parents, does your child snore very much? If there's a lot of snoring going on, we worry that they're not sleeping soundly, for one thing, has a bad impact on your eventual development. And in rare cases, the kids don't wake up. They don't get enough oxygen and the guy is asleep. So we're very cautious about those types of symptoms for sleep apnea. And we talked about it, we talked about. So talking about behavior, you know, again, the average child with Down syndrome is generally pretty happy, pretty However, they have the other side as well. They do have a tendency for tantrums, which terrible twos in the typical developing population turns into terrible threes and fours in the Down syndrome population, so the tantrums come a little bit later, and they stick around a little longer. So when your two-year-old might get out of them a little faster, your child with Down syndrome might tantrum a little bit longer. And the length of the tantrum, but actually how many years they tantrum. More of a tendency to have hyperactivity for children with Down syndrome and attention issues. Some of the kids will actually become self-injurious, so they might bite themselves, hit themselves in the head, bang their head on the floor, bang their forehead on the floor. Often it's a behavior tactic. They know they get what they want when they do that. To some extent, it's a frustration issue. They just can't get their point across. They can't do what they see all the other kids doing, and they get upset and frustrated, and this is the way they take it out. And it's just a matter of trying to find more appropriate ways for them to express those problems. They can also be aggressive toward others, often the same types of triggers. So they want the little toy that Johnny is playing with, but they can't explain to Johnny that they want to turn, so they try to grab it, and Johnny's not happy about that, and then, you know, okay, I have to go. So a little bit more apt to push or hit. And if they're trying to get the child's attention, they may do that too. So they don't maybe have the social skills to be able to go up to a group of kids and say, I want to play with you, but they want to be involved. So what they may do is run up to the group and push one of the kids, or slap them or something. You think it's counterproductive, but it's the only way that they know to get attention, to get built into the group, and recognizing that helps us to explain how they could do that differently, as opposed to punishing them for the activity and say, here's how you would go and join this group of kids. So moving to kids who are a little bit older and heading off to school, muscle tone is improving, certainly strength is getting better, still an issue with the joint laxity that we are cautious with. And I think this study was 2001, so it wasn't all that old, but they were trying to look at what attainment kids have had. And when they looked at these tasks, running away 15 feet and returning, walking up two stairs without using the railing, and using both feet to jump forward, those three things, about half the kids by age 5 could accomplish all three of those things. So there's still a lot of work to do, and you're helping with the types of activities you're doing, helps get these kids to this point faster. Because that extra exercise, that extra practice really does make a difference for them. And so they require more time to learn these things. As the complexity of what they're trying to master goes up, it takes a lot longer for them to master something. That's why the early things that they're working on seem to come faster to them than the later things. So that repetition really makes a difference for these guys. Children with Down syndrome have a little bit higher tendency to have what we call stereotypies, which would be things like rocking, their body, rubbing on their skin, flapping their fingers in front of their eyes, those types of things, which sometimes makes people afraid that they have autism. Autistic children will do many of those activities that have poor language development, both of which happens in Down syndrome. And to some extent, there's a different quality that we can identify that, no, this is just really a comfort measure, not really an autistic behavior. And usually it's because you can, with attention and moving them on to something else, they're much happier to do something else. Whereas a child with autism might really prefer to stay rocking their or flapping their fingers than engaging in an activity. However, about 5% of children with Down syndrome also have autism, so they can sometimes go together. So these are some school-age girls in Nigeria who are learning in their classroom. Issues that are still there are PDC. We are monitoring for scoliosis and flat feet, which are fairly common, still with the thyroid every year. Still with the dry skin. Children with Down syndrome have a higher chance of getting various autoimmune disorders, those are things like lupus and arthritis and things like that. But one of those things can also attack your hair follicles, so those patches of hair that completely fall out. They can lose all of the hair on their body, then they grow back and fall out. And that medically is called alopecia, which is a higher chance to happen in Down syndrome. We watch their vision and hearing, continuing to do that. This was actually a toddler, but I threw her in here because she just sort of looked like she had a little attitude going on. So we talked a little bit about the fact that there may be some attention issues, and that's critical when you're trying to work with a child to make sure you maintain their attention, knowing that their attention span may only be a little briefer. And the general rule of thumb is to essentially, you may be dealing with an 8-year-old, so if you know other 8-year-olds, you just have to change your expectations because mentally that child's probably not an 8-year-old, the child might be a 5. 5-year-old or 4-year-old or 6-year-old. So you have to get a sense of where are they developmentally, and then gauge their activity level, their attention span, based on where their mental process is, rather than a chronologic age before deciding, oh my gosh, this kid is really hyperactive. Parents of children with Down syndrome will tell you that the one of the hardest things they deal with is stubbornness and oppositionality. So I'm doing it my way. I don't care how long it takes. I don't care if we're late for church. I'm going to put my shoes on all by myself. And it becomes a struggle for busy families to try to get to an appointment or whatnot. And they are going to be pretty adamant. They're not going to back down. We just talked about the chance of autism, some of the aggressive behaviors. On the other side, sometimes these kids are too effective. So they have to sometimes learn that now that you're not a toddler anymore and you're in fifth grade, you can't run up and give somebody a big old hug. Because they may not like that. And to some extent, it's also a danger. And we have to make sure these kids understand that they can't run up to any guy in the street and give them a big hug. So we have to help them understand boundaries and whatnot. And I find that sometimes I forget about that. I love the kids that I deal with, and I really want to give them a hug and whatnot. And sometimes the parents will throw things at you. No, I'm trying to teach you not to hug any people. So it's helpful to ask families sometimes about those types of things. School age is when the peer issues become important to obviously all children. The same is true for children with Down syndrome. And especially for our children with Down syndrome who are functioning at a higher level, this is when they start to realize, hey, I'm not the same as everybody else. I can't do the same thing the other kids do. I don't get invited to the same parties these kids get invited to. So it starts to become important to them, and they start to ask questions about why they're different. A higher tendency for kids to sort of just decide to bolt or walk off. These are kids who, as I said, are starting to recognize that they can't do things as well. Sometimes their response to a challenge is to avoid it. So if you're asking for them to do something they feel they really can't master, you might find them trying to head for the door and run off on you. So lots of good supervision, and families have tried to set lots of good rules with kids. We try to have protection on the outside doors for the houses so kids can't run off into a dangerous situation. And another thing that's so unique to people with Down syndrome is because they're so social, they become extremely good at manipulating you and doing things for them. So they become very good at asking for help more than they should. And again, that's what's helpful, to really talk to families and find out, do I really need to tie your kid's shoes for her, or can she do it on her own if I ask her to do it? If you're asking them to do something challenging, you're saying, oh, help me, it's just so adorable, you just kind of want to help them out. But to some extent, you have to rein yourself in and say, no, let's see how well you can do it first, and help them with that. Moving on now to the teenage years, adolescent years. I don't know if anyone's familiar with this young man. I have to stand one hand in his name, his town, and all that kind of stuff. But he's on a basketball team where all the coaches in the area that play the school know that he's there. He has Down syndrome. They call him out onto the court periodically. And I guess, generally speaking, the other team will kind of back off, let this guy score, but they let him score once. Then they get back into the competition. It's really been a tremendous thing for him, and it seems like a very tremendous thing for the community that everybody's behind this kid and backing him, not even just his own town, but all the surrounding towns. And it's really been fabulous for the whole community. But we're still dealing with some of the same types of difficulties with muscle tone and joint problems. Balance issues become, are sort of always an issue, but become more apparent as people get older. Their muscle tone is low, so they have to break posture sometimes. When they're walking, they don't do the typical thing with their arm motion that all the rest of us do. And we're back again to the speech difficulties with both articulation and grammar rules aren't always well used. From a medical standpoint, we start to run more into obesity in the teenage and young adult age years. Thyroid problems are still there. There are a variety of skin problems. One of the unique things when they hit adolescence is a tendency to get boils, painful, swollen, little infections, usually in their groin area, around their buttocks, under their armpits. They're very tender, they hurt, and they're chronic. Something different with the immune system that doesn't quite keep those infections under control. Still with something with heat issues like unstable knees, whatnot. And because children are much more integrated into society now than they ever used to be in the past, this is becoming more and more obvious of an issue and more possible as an issue, in fact. But again, it's important to make sure that people understand that there are predators out there, people that want to take advantage of them for appropriate reasons, and that they have appropriate sex education. When we move into the young adults, this information I think is probably out of date today, and I apologize, I was working on this fairly quickly and I didn't throw in any of the references, but in one of the studies that was done, they found that less than half of young adults with Down syndrome were fully independent for each of the feeding, hygiene, dressing, toileting areas. So they might be in three out of four, but they weren't fully independent in all four. Most of the young adults that I see have mastered certainly toileting and dressing, and hygiene, and to a large extent I think feeding as well, which is why I think this is kind of out of date. But there's the general rule of thumb is that complete independent thing is not likely for most adults with Down syndrome, in part because of cognitive issues, and in part because of unique issues with Down syndrome that they, for a reason that aren't clear, are not as good at self-preservation as other people with the exact same IQ level. So it's not just a cognitive issue. And perhaps that's because the children are more altruistic and they'll run back into the burning building to try to help somebody else out of the burning building, or exactly what it is, they've never quite sorted out. Complete independent living is not necessarily going to be possible. And I find it's an interesting dynamic with families. You know, for years and years, from the time this child is born, this family has fought tooth and nail for their child to be considered like all the other children. And I want my child in the same school, on the same soccer team, and going to parties with the other kids and doing all the stuff that other kids do. And then they hit their teenage years and the parents say, get a driver's license? No, I want my child to get a driver's license. Have my child move out of the house into an apartment? I'm not ready for that. So there's this strange sort of shift as they get older towards teenagers and young adulthood that suddenly the family's backing away from the idea of complete normalcy because they're frightened. How will their child be able to do in the real world? It's realistic and it's just an interesting sort of dynamic when you talk to families about it. Medical issues are all still there as people get older. Scoliosis, interestingly, in child and typically developing children is more common during their teenage years, and in Down syndrome is still occurring in adults. Again, with behavior things, trying to sort that independence versus dependence, their desire for relationships and their emergent sexuality. Depression can occur up to 10% of folks with Down syndrome, usually around the age of 29. And to a large extent, that's, I think, very reflective of the fact that they are not independent like most of their age peers would be at this age. That plays a big part of it. A little more tendency towards anxiety and withdrawal. And as you move into older adults, this is a young man in China who is involved in the orchestra that he conducts. So we still deal with some of the same types of things. There's a tendency for very slow, methodical movement for older adults with Down syndrome, in part reflective of their muscle tone issues, in part reflective of their balance issues. A little bit more unsteady on their feet. Some of that's also just physics. Their feet tend to be a little bit smaller and the body is heavy and lowered to the ground, so I think they don't have quite as good ability to maintain their stability. They still have heart issues and obesity. And unfortunately, Alzheimer's disease is fairly common in Down syndrome. They've determined through a variety of studies that essentially all individuals with Down syndrome over the age of 35 will have the brain changes that we see in Alzheimer's disease. Does not mean they have it or will get it, but we certainly see the changes. And they see dementia in about 30% of people, and it's at a younger age than in the general population, so much higher frequency. Again, if you think about where these numbers will come from, these are people who are at least in their 50s or 60s now, and probably even older than that because of when the studies were done. So these are people who didn't have the same opportunities as the people that you're working with now. So maybe that we see that this degree of dementia goes down as we have better health and better education for children with Down syndrome throughout their lives. So what is it that you should hopefully be taking away from my blathering up here for the last hour? Essentially being aware of the physical and motor differences and behavior differences of children with Down syndrome, particularly as they may relate to safety of the activities that you're doing with them. Being aware of their cognitive differences and making sure you're teaching at the right level. You don't want to be, you know, treating them like they're too little or trying to teach them shut down? Are they going to run away? Are they going to tantrum? You know, or with good encouragement, can they move along? What works to avoid that particular child? And then also, I suggest being aware of what's going on with the family. You know, I've mentioned a little bit that over the lifetime of a child, there's a shift in how families are doing. Families will say that at the time their child is diagnosed with Down syndrome, that they really go through essentially a grieving process, a grief process. Nowadays, most of the children are identified before birth, but sometimes it's still quite a surprise in the delivery room. And the grieving process is really more the idea that you're grieving the loss of the child that you had anticipated you were going to have, with all those plans and things you probably were making in your head. You have to make an adjustment to the child that you do have. And families make that adjustment well, but they do go through many of the same stages as we. And I warn families about that, and I tell them, for one thing, you're not necessarily going to be in the same place as your husband or wife will be at any given time. Extended family members may not recognize what they're going through. And I also warn families that it will come and go. You know, early on, it's fairly obvious they're going to have some good days and some bad days. But families get shocked sometimes that, you know, their child's in fifth grade and all of a sudden mom wakes up one morning and she's just really depressed and sad that their child is Down syndrome again. Oh, wow, I dealt with this. I'm totally fine with it. Where is this coming from? And there's usually something, and it's usually a milestone that's coming up. You know, all the kids in the neighborhood are doing something and their child's not there yet developmentally. So it kind of, at various points throughout their life, will kind of re-hit them again. Oh, we were just talking about that. And then it's nice when you have the capability to be a sibling. So, you know, Lisa was telling me that one of the things that's nice about your program is that when the other kids in the family are running off to soccer in the morning, you know, these kids can come here and get their special time as well, and that's fabulous. But when you see siblings around, it's nice to acknowledge them, find what their names are. Sometimes a child with Down syndrome takes so much of the family's energy and time that the siblings get a little bit kind of left out, and it's just helpful for them to realize how important they are. And most important of all is to just have fun. So. I know I talked for quite a while this morning and whatnot, and didn't take too many breaths for questions, but does anybody have any questions?
I just have a question. Have you seen any of this being hereditary?
So in Down syndrome, because the way it is the extra chromosome, it tends not to be hereditary. As women get older, their eggs, which you're born with all the eggs you're ever going to have, they're also older, and that seems to be the reason why the chromosomes fail to separate properly. And you get two chromosomes to stay together where they should separate. It can be that it's in the sperm rather than the egg, but that's fairly rare, which is why we worry about Down syndrome when women are over 35. The vast majority of babies with Down syndrome are still born to women who are less than 35, because those are women having babies to a larger extent, although that seems to be shifting as well. The type where the chromosomes are physically stuck together can be a situation where that's passed on from one generation to the next. For people with Down syndrome, when they're adults, and as they've talked about, things have changed now. So adults with Down syndrome have on occasion gotten married and have on occasion had children. So because they start with 47 chromosomes, when they're making an egg, they're gonna make one with 24 chromosomes and one with 23. If the one with 24 chromosomes is the one that gets fertilized, that child will also have Down syndrome. There's a problem with the hormonal system for both men and women with Down syndrome, so that fertility is lower than expected in the general population. And then, of course, there's always the cognitive concerns about, are these people prepared to raise children? And unfortunately, as I went through the literature trying to sort out how many pregnancies and deliveries there have been for children, people with Down syndrome, the literature is very out of date. No one's kept up with it. And there was a higher chance of birth defects that weren't Down syndrome, which I couldn't understand. It makes no sense why there would be a higher chance of birth defects. When I finally went back to the 1930s and 40s to find that actual original literature, it was because the vast majority of those pregnancies were the result of incest for an unfortunate, retarded individual who's not cared for probably by their family. So that was the explanation for the anomalies. Nowadays, as I said, the issue would be they're going to have a child with Down syndrome. Hopefully that answers your question. Any other questions? Yes.
Is there a test that people can take to predict
So if you're, so if you wanted to find out now, you know, should I have a child with Down syndrome, or is it a test that's helpful, because it's not something most people would care. And we don't have a way right now of assessing the chromosomes inside the egg or the sperm before conception. question without just drawing it, so it doesn't matter either. So really, the methods are, after conception, during pregnancy, there are a variety of blood tests that they can do on the mother and ultrasounds. And sequentially putting all this data together, they can about 98% of the time identify a pregnancy that is affected with Down syndrome. It's, however, still a pregnancy. It's still there. So for some families, they will take that information and terminate the pregnancy. Other families will take that information and say, okay, we're prepared, we know what we're doing. But in terms of folks that really are concerned, suppose it's a 44-year-old person who has a reasonably high chance of having a child with Down syndrome, and infertility issues, if they decide to go through in vitro fertilization, you can actually, after the eggs and sperm are put together in the lab dish and you get about 8 cells, they can take one cell away and study the chromosomes and only return the embryos back to the womb that don't have Down syndrome or other chromosome things. So that technology can be used as well. It's probably got a higher chance of finding a chromosome problem that's not real than missing a chromosome problem that's there, but either are possible. Yes?
Is there a shorter life expectancy with people with Down syndrome?
There is. It's getting better and better all the time, again, with better medical care and education and whatnot. But it's probably the last statistics that we have are lifespan into the 60s and 70s. But again, those are people that were born 60 and 70 years ago, so it's still not the same as people born today, which the assumption is going to be that for children born today, that their lifespan will be similar to what our lifespan is now, but that our lifespan for typically developing children will also grow. So there will always be some discrepancy between the two. And to some extent, it's that if we can't sort out what causes the Alzheimer's disease, that would be one of the biggest factors in decreasing the lifespan if we can't sort that one out. Yes?
You mentioned in toddlers, they have sleep apnea.
Mm-hmm.
Do they use the similar treatments for regular sleep apnea? Do they put the mask? Because I know that with difference, it might be too difficult.
Yeah, it's a tough one. So for children, if we're seeing an epidemic of sleep apnea now, we're seeing an epidemic of obesity in children. But the typical things that we do first are to take out the adenoids. We try to leave the tonsils. They're actually an important part of the immune system, but sometimes both the adenoids and the tonsils have to go. If that doesn't solve the apnea problem, then we move on to, kind of depends on what's happening. It might be that the little nubula that hangs down the back of the throat can be kind of tacked out of the way, and that might help. But then we often go to the CPAP mask. And you're right, the kids often just can't tolerate it, can't learn about it. And I've had families, I'm afraid for them. When we do their sleep studies, we document the apnea, we try to bring the CPAP mask, it doesn't work. And family says there's really nothing else I can do. So sometimes the kids are sleeping like in the room with the family so they can be aware of what's happening with them. Unfortunately, we don't have great monitoring technology. The monitors are so sensitive, they go off constantly to the point that they're really useful. So we tend not to most of the time have home apnea monitors, but they do exist. So.
Time for one last question before I turn back to Lisa. Anyone else? What about the area of cosmetic surgery
some families have come to us asking for cosmetic surgery. We have a plastic surgery team that comes out to our office every other month. And we're sort of split, I think, to attitudes. I think that the plastic surgeons may be a little bit more realistic and have said, you know, there are certainly studies that show that take an individual with Down syndrome and correct the appearance around the eyes, that they are then treated differently and treated more as a typical person. But realistically, also the same plastic surgeons will say, but that may actually be more of a disservice. Because now you have, if you have a young adult with Down syndrome who walks into a store, or you are in the store and they are working at the store, there's an almost instantaneous identification of the fact that this person is going to interact with you differently than the other clerk that doesn't have Down syndrome. If you correct those features, that instantaneous recognition is gone, for better or worse. And the worst thing is, people are going to not have anywhere near the kind of patience and understanding of a person who quote unquote looks normal, who acts differently. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. There are certainly On paper, yes, they're going to get better opportunities, but you have to look at that person's abilities and decide if it's realistic. So we have one young man whose family has been thinking about it. He has an extraordinarily difficult time speaking. And I think people are much more patient with him, looking at him and knowing it's Down syndrome. If his features are corrected, I think people won't have quite the same patience that they have been. And he's started out with him. I think they still want to move forward. But, so for the vast majority of families, it's not something that they need to consider. But it's certainly out there, and the kids who are more, the young adults who are more higher functioning, I think it's more considered as a way of helping them have a better opportunity.
Okay, we'll turn back to Lisa then.
Thank you all for your attention, and hope you have a follow-up.